Hey everyone, Wolflord Ro here. Before I begin today, a huge thank you to NordPanzer for the virtual gift voucher. Huge thank you, my friend, for the support. It is truly appreciated. Thank you. But on to today. Today we are reviewing Dark Imperium: Godblight by Guy Haley. As usual for reviews, we'll begin with a non-spoiler review, followed by some spoiler thoughts and reactions. Now, before we begin reading the synopsis off the back of the novel, as we know, Godblight is the third and final installment to the Dark Imperium trilogy. And I've had a few people ask me whether they needed to reread the updated first two novels, Dark Imperium and Dark Imperium Plague Wars, before they can jump into Godblight. Now, in rereading the first two, there are noticeable changes, and I would lean on the side of recommending it. However, there's no changes big enough to make you feel lost or overly confused if you don't, at least in my opinion. So if you can't afford to rebuy them, or you just don't have the time, or simply can't wait to jump into Godblight, I think you'll be okay. So, with that said, let's just jump in and read the synopsis off the back of the book. The paths of Rabute Gilliman and his fallen brother Mortarion bring them inexorably together on Iax. Once a jewel of the Imperium, the Garden World is dying, as the plans of the Lord of Death to use it as a fulcrum to drag the stellar realm of Ultramar into the warp come to deadly fruition. While Gilliman attempts to prevent the destruction of his kingdom, Mortarion schemes to bring his brother low with the Godblight, a disease created in the Cauldron of Nurgle itself, made with the power to destroy a son of the Emperor. Primarchs clash on the ravaged landscapes of Iax, the gods go to war, and the wider galaxy balances on a knife edge of destruction. As something powerful stirs in the Sea of Souls, only one thing is certain. No matter who wins the last great clash of the Plague War, the repercussions of victory will echo through eternity. Okay, Godblight, the finale of the Dark Imperium trilogy, essentially the main storyline for the current 40k universe. And first up, let's be honest here, the big advantage this novel has, the entire series has, is that it follows Rabute Gilliman himself firsthand. He's not a side character. He's not always mentioned but rarely seen. Rabute is front and center to the story, because it is his story. Now, I'll admit I did feel a little strange returning to Gilliman after what feels quite a while. Combined with the often discussed timeline shift, I was almost going in feeling a little confused before I even got to the first pages. And that's still having refreshed my memory by reading the new updated previous editions. However, within a few pages, the mere presence of Gilliman sets your mind at ease. The Primarch's depiction throughout the novel, and indeed the whole series, has remained consistent and true to character. The Gilliman you expect is the Gilliman you receive. And while that may not sound like much, it's actually something that can go wrong more than you'd expect. And it's doubly impressive when we consider the story arc Rabute Gilliman has been going through. The personal struggles, as well as the political, are getting no easier for Rabute as we advance into this novel. And though you may find yourself surprised by some of the Primarch's decisions and actions, you'll always understand why he is doing what he is. Even if you may disagree with the outcome, you will understand Rabute's rationale. I, for one, can't help think it could very easily come back to haunt him, be it from the powers that be within the Imperium, or perhaps if certain brothers of his ever return. Now, of course, the driving force of the story is the confrontation with Mortarion, and though yes, you have to wait to get there, it most certainly does not disappoint. Obviously, I can't give away any spoilers here, but I was quite literally fidgeting in my seat with excitement. When the two brothers finally confronted each other, it did not disappoint. Now, it does have a slight tinge of déjà vu, with it feeling at times we've heard parts of their conversation before. And I haven't compared the original Plague Wars and the re-edited one word for word, but I did get the sense a couple of remarks or two had been moved to this final encounter. Maybe not, but like I said, there was just a twinge of déjà vu. Again, don't get me wrong here, the culmination of the three novel long build-up was absolutely worth it. Guy Haley absolutely knows how to build the emotion in these pivotal moments, while still managing to keep it feeling like you're living something truly epic. He gave us Horus vs. Russ in Wolfsbane, Dante's Last Stand in Devastation of Baal, and now Gilliman vs. Mortarion in Godblight. If you've ever watched the old school British film Zulu, or Lord of the Rings Two Towers for a more modern comparison, you'll understand when I say this book is all about building to this one climactic moment. And it's the type of story Guy Haley clearly excels at. Now, for all the talk of this main narrative, there are of course a whole host of supporting characters. Decimus Felix continues his advance to being one of the more prominent characters in the current setting, though I admit I struggle to find him interesting. It's not that he's badly written by any means, it's just for me there's something missing from his character. There's nothing that really helps me gravitate towards him. Unlike another prominent son of Gilliman, in Cato Sicarius. The guy might be polarizing, but when his name's on the page, you immediately feel business picking up. For all Felix's appointment as Tetrarch, there's no doubting Sicarius definitely still has more gravitas than him. The star of the show in the supporting cast environment, however, absolutely has to go to the greater demon Kugath, who, continuing in his tenuous alliance with Mortarion, just finds his character truly coming alive. Whether it's his interplay with fellow Unclean One Rottigus, or a vocal moment in conversation with himself, I just found him a joy to read, and I think it would be a crying shame if he doesn't get a chance to shine again. The forces of Nurgle occupy a strange place within the 40k universe. It may be all grimdark, but their positive and humorous outlook manages to find itself being comical without feeling out of place. I would absolutely love to see Guy Haley taking on Kugath once more. So, overall, I do find this one a little tricky to score. The epic moments are indeed every inch epic, but there are a few rather bland moments in between. However, honestly, the high points are so exhilarating to read, and by that I especially mean that final confrontation, there's no way I couldn't give this a 5 out of 5. Any book dealing with Primarchs that has you jumping and fidgeting in your seat with excitement, nervousness, and everything in between, honestly deserves nothing less. So Dark Imperium Godblight is 5 out of 5 blessed by the Emperor. Okay, so that's it for our spoiler-free review. Now on to a little spoiler reaction and talk. Man, where do I begin? I guess in all honesty, it's really about that final confrontation. But before we get there, man, was anybody else surprised to see Gilliman freely entertaining Eldari support? Having an Eldar within his conclave of psykers. I know the Eldari may have been involved in his resurrection, but that was something he was never happy about, at least previously within the lore. So seeing this far more accepting behaviour, especially in light of his troubles with the Ecclesiarchy, not to mention the Inquisition and High Lords of Terror, really is surprising. I just can't help but think Rabute is running the risk of digging his own grave. At least politically speaking. And this was exactly what I was referring to when speaking of his brother's return. I can't think of a single one of them who would be approving of this action. Especially the most likely to return next, Lion L. Johnson. The whole situation is going to be bad enough, let alone when he finds out Gilliman is working with Eldari. Man, L. Johnson's reaction keeps going from bad to worse. When news of the Lion returning reaches Gilliman's ears, man, he is going to have some mixed emotions. Elated that a brother has returned, and dreading him finding out just what Gilliman has been up to. Like I said, next week we're really going to begin breaking it all down and discussing these points all the more. But I think we all have to admit it's not adding up brilliantly for Rabute, should it all come out into the open. Especially when you add in the Book of Sanguinius' Reign of the Imperium Secundus. Now, this book being found was the weakest part of the story for me. I found the whole McCragg sections of the book a little bland, and I get the probable aim of the storyline being a major revelation for this history to get out in the open. I just find it a little hard to buy a book would cause a major living, breathing Primarch, the only returned son of the Emperor and Lord Commander of the Imperium, any real problems. I mean, if it was that bad, you would have just burned the book a long time ago. But hopefully I'm surprised and they try and make a good storyline out of it. I am more than hopeful at being proved wrong. An evolution of Sanguinius within the Warp, perhaps? We've already seen his spirit alive and well within the Immaterium. So now that's a discussion worth having. But of course it's all about the Emperor's awakening. And after discussing it on the channel over the past few months, it was nothing short of exhilarating to see it all in action. Whether the Emperor wanted it or not, he is a god, fueled by the faith of mankind. The narrative direction has now once and for all been truly cast into the open. We got so much in those few short pages, so many repercussions and questions for the future. The resurrection of Gilliman, the possible redemption of Mortarion, the fact that the Emperor is so powerful his presence moves through the Warp, akin to a Chaos God, or even the Hive Mind, and honestly probably more powerful, it's definitely something to behold. Man, what a time to be alive. We saw the Emperor's power burning Nurgle's garden without any fear of retaliation. I don't think the Chaos Gods have been this scared of the Anathema since before the heresy. They may have always truly feared him, but now they'll be absolutely bricking it. The possibilities that Godblight has opened are now more than ever truly exciting. But as always guys, what do you think? Are you looking forward to reading Godblight? Or have you, and did it live up to your expectations? As always, leave your thoughts in the comments below, I love to read them. Huge thank you to all my subscribers, your support truly means a lot to me, it really does. And if you're new, please consider subscribing to help the channel grow. But with that said, I am off, and I'll see you all again real soon.